is your worth. And Father, I just thank you that you are excited about what is happening inside of our hearts. So Lord, I just thank you for all that you, all your plans and all your purposes that you have for today. In Jesus' name. Thank you, Father. Amen. I was just thinking during worship today, it was actually kind of hard for me because for the longest time I actually, I did work, and I still do worship sometimes, but for the longest time, since starting this church about 5 years ago, I've done a lot of stuff, most stuff, from organizing to administration to phone calls to youth to men's cell group. The only thing I really didn't do was women's cell. And I got one laugh, all right. So that's really the only thing I didn't do, or young women's cell or something like that. But I'm really recognizing that what qualifies somebody to have influence is that they have something to actually give. Does that make sense? What qualifies you to go and buy a car is that you have the money to buy a car. And there's obviously some other stuff that you need to have, like a license, and like, some sort of awe. But the reality, by the way, my heart just coming to you is not to give a... Oh, there's no balloons. She's harassing. My heart coming today is not to give you a three-point sermon, but to really share my heart tonight. But I just noticed when I stand up here and do worship on any given Friday night, I can literally feel substance coming out of me. I can literally feel the anointing of the Holy Spirit as the tangible presence of God. I don't know if anyone's ever felt the presence of God and got like goosebumps or something before it. Because the presence of God is a tangible. The presence of God is something, it's not just a simple feeling. Oftentimes feelings are tangible, but the presence of God is substantial. The presence of God is, I almost said the French for some reason, the presence of God is material. Except it's not material in the realm that we see it, but it's material in the spiritual realm. So if somebody stands up here and leads worship, you can often gauge, just glue in with me right now, guys, because I'm going on a little bit of a different level here. You can often gauge the relationship with God that they walk in through just listening to them lead worship. That's why people flock to a Kim Walker concert or a Delirious concert or something like that, because they are releasing a substance. What made them popular was the reality of the presence of God through their lives, through their identities as people, but through their gifts, through the words, it releases something substantial. And that's why people like it. It's not just simply they're good looking. You know, there's actually substance coming from them. So just starting off on that basis, one of the questions I've asked the Lord many times is, God, how come there's like 10,000 believers in this city, or 5,000, or however many there is? There's tons. There's 101 churches in Lambton County, and there's only like 90,000 people. So 101 churches, 90,000 people, how many people is that? I'd wager that it's got to be like at least 7,000, 8,000. Don't know for a fact, but there's thousands of and thousands of believers in this city. How come there's still so much darkness in this city? If there's so many dang believers, if there's so many people that claim to love Jesus, how come there's so much darkness? How come there's so much sin? How come there's still so much destruction? How come there's still how come there's still young people this year, numbers of them, that have committed suicide? How come there's all this stuff happening? And it's really this, it's the reality that there's many people that they are a believer, but they haven't entered into the place yet where they're a bona fide disciple of Jesus Christ, and that they release something through their lives. Many believers haven't made the transition from going to church on Sunday or on Friday to actually being the church throughout the week. Because there's a big difference in attending a service on a Sunday or a Friday or whatever the day is, and then being Jesus in your workplace. Being Jesus in your school. Being Jesus at Walmart. Being Jesus at the skateboard park. Being Jesus where you go. And really what I mean by being Jesus is just doing the stuff that Jesus modeled for us to do by the power of the Holy Spirit. Does that make sense? So if you're going to actually be Jesus, you need something to give. You need an authentic relationship with God that when you speak with people, that their lives are changed. So that's I just want to prelude that with my message, which is this thought tonight, that the goal or the vision of one of the main goals of this church is simply this: every believer an influencer. In other words, every believer doing what they can with their spiritual gifts, with their money, with their time, with their talents, with what they have inside of them. Every believer exercising their what they can do with who they are to impact people with the love of Christ. See, when you start doing that, that's when life gets exciting. See, if I ask most people in here tonight, when's the last time, well, not everyone's, you know, let me pray a little bit. When's the last time that you led someone to Jesus Christ? You don't have to answer, just think about it. This isn't an evangelistic message. This is a love message. God's, I'm actually going to preach it on Tuesday to the youth. I'm going to call it Boldness 101. But God's been teaching me that doing what we can for the kingdom of God, and doing what we can for Jesus, it's not about simply I'm an evangelist or not, or I'm called to preach the gospel or not. Everyone is called to share, but it's a love message. Has the love of Christ gotten deep enough inside of you that it comes out? It's like Jesus Christ is the seed, right? The Bible calls him the seed of Abraham. So when a seed goes inside of the ground, usually what happens to healthy seeds is what? They grow, and they don't just pop out and grow into like one little green thing popping out of the ground. But they grow into something that produces life. They grow into something that produces fruit. They grow into something that is life-giving, and that produces substance. So that's what I want to talk about tonight. I want to talk about the substance of God's healing power, and I like how that orange thing is like kind of, I don't know if you guys see it, but it almost looks like a little sun or something. That's kind of cool. So I want to start off. If you don't know what orange thing I'm talking about this thing right here. Just, I saw some faces going. So maybe you just couldn't see it. Through somebody's head or something. Not just that. I want to start with a testimony. One of the things that God's doing in me is he's asking me to step back a little bit so that other people can step up. I remember when, when I first started stepping out and stuff. I mean, I remember the very first preach I gave. I was 18 years old at my youth group at River City Vineyard, and man, did it suck. I mean, I was fumbling. I was, not that it has to suck. Your first preach doesn't have to suck, but it sucked bad. I mean, it was terrible. I mean, I thought I was ready, and I got up there, and I'm like, I couldn't even hardly get two straight words out. I mean, it was just terrible. And definitely come a long way in the last, 9, 10 years from, from then. But so I actually didn't go to the youth group that that I started a year ago. We started it, I remember the first meeting we had 10 people, and now we kind of have about 50, 60 plugged in, and some of them more loosely than others. And so I think, I don't know how many kids were there on Tuesday night, about 30 or something. And it was good. But God told me, stay back and I want Mike to preach. So I stayed back, and it was actually really hard for me, because it's hard sometimes. I think that's one of the problems with some pastors and some leaders and even business owners and stuff. They just try and do everything. And what God's showing me now is you need to step back and start letting people step up. Even if they can't do it as well as you, they need to learn and they need to grow. And in order to do that, I don't get it. Okay.
Still doesn't get it, Mike.
All right, moving along. So I stepped back and Mike stepped up to the plate and everyone, we did stuff. Even this time, I feel God held me back tonight. I walked in here at about 5 to 7. Usually I'm scurrying around here. I get here at about 5:30. I'm doing everything. I'm getting the PowerPoint ready. You know, if I had my way, this would be turned more this way, and it'd be straight, and I measure this up, and I put that there, and I get everyone running around doing a bunch of stuff, and I just set it up really nice and tight. This time, I didn't do anything. I just walked in here 10 to 7, and I just saw, I'm like, okay, what do we got here? Where are we at? If I was to leave the picture, would Dunamis Church still go on? If I took my element out of what's happening tonight, would there still be a pressing forward? Would stuff still happen? At this point, I think we're getting there. I think we're farther along than we've ever been before. So praise God for that. But I know that, and I'm not being arrogant right now, I just know that in and of my life, there is a tremendous substance. There's stuff that I can feel it even now. When I speak, I feel the anointing of the Holy Spirit. I feel the power of God when I'm talking into a microphone. Usually, if I don't, then I just want to put the thing down and say, well, I'm done, because anytime I try to get up and preach without the anointing of God's Holy Spirit, I might as well not, because you don't need my words, you need His words that He's put in this man's heart. Amen? That's what we need tonight, is we need the anointed Word of God. But so, long story short, I didn't go to the youth, and I felt someone actually gave me kind of a prophetic word, and I went at about 9:15, and I thought, well, I'll just hang out. I felt like the Lord wanted me to go. And so I get there at about 9:15, and it was just closing up. They were done. Usually they hang out till like 10. And I look across the road, and there's like 10, 12 guys, so like all on bikes and skateboards and stuff, just young guys, talking with two or three or four of the girls. Actually, it was three or four of the girls that were at the youth. They aren't here tonight. Some of them haven't made the transition to Friday nights yet, so we're still praying. But because... that's a whole other thing, because Friday night's really where the rubber meets the road. Youth cell is good, but this is where it's like, boom. But, so I decided, well, let's go over there and see what's going on. I haven't seen a couple of these girls in a while, so I walk over, and one of the kids goes, I kind of recognized him, he goes, oh, it's Jesus, peace. Because they thought I was Jesus or something. That's a great compliment, but, so... 10 of these guys, 10 or 12 of these guys kind of peace out, and I'm like, I look at the girls that I knew, and I'm like, looks like I just busted up the parties. And they were like, so they left too, and I'm standing there alone, I'm just like, alright, this is good. And so I'm like, you know what, let's have a little fun. I didn't say that to myself, but it was fun. So I walk over to these, they all went over to like the skateboard, or the hill part, at the skateboard park, the big cement hill. And so I walk over there, and I just, this thing rose up in me. What was it? It was, I'll explain it in a minute, but it was the substance of God's love and of His passion. Something rose up inside of me, and I said, man, like, this isn't right. And so I walked over to these guys, and I just lifted up my voice, and I said, hey, guys! I said, I'm the real, something like this, like, paraphrasing. I said, I'm the real deal. And so, I come over here and I just want to share the love of God with you. I said, bring me somebody who's in pain right now, and I guarantee God will heal them. If he doesn't, I'm like 99% sure. I mean, if he doesn't heal them, I'll leave. But if he does, you're going to know that God's real. So they're like, all right, well, Ruth here is sick to try to find someone, and one guy has a broken shoulder bone. Or a shoulder, sorry, broken collarbone. Oh, by the way, I happened to Word of Knowledge later, of course. But this guy has a collarbone that he busted up, and there's still pain. So long story short, we pray for him, healed. Boom. Another guy has something wrong with his knee that he just busted up. It was all swollen. Pray for him, healed. Boom. These kids are like, now, if it was 100%, or like 80 or 90%, the pain was leaving and stuff, and it was awesome. So they're like clapping now. They're like, yay. God. And so I just thought, you know what? I should give an altar call or something. There's an altar there. I should give a skateboard hill call, whatever you want to call it. So I said, who here, wants to receive Jesus right now? And I didn't really have time to. So I just preached the gospel for a bit and shared the love of Christ with people. And we're doing all right there. I should preach with my niece in my hand. This up a little bit. But the point of the story is this. I didn't just come to them with mere words. I didn't just come to them with just some thoughts about how Jesus can make their life better. I came to them with substance. The real presence of God that healed a couple of their pains. And now they know that this guy is the real deal. Not because I'm a great preacher and I broke down theology on the skateboard park. It was because of a couple simple prayers. And even though I'm kind of weird like that, the power of God came. The substance of the Holy Spirit came. And he changed. And God, I believe God impacted their lives. Now I'm not just some Jesus freak to them. Now there's open doors of communication. Next time I go and see those kids, they're going to know. They're going to remember the miracles. They're going to bring more. There's open doors. Now, does a miracle equal somebody getting saved and becoming a disciple of Jesus? No. That's relationship. That's a whole bunch of other stuff that will equal that. But what a miracle does equal is a miracle equals an open door of communication. A miracle equals somebody who didn't believe in God at all coming along the kind of scale of, I don't believe it all to, I don't know, maybe it's a possibility. As somebody who's like, I don't know, maybe it's a possibility, coming to the place where, you know what, I think this might be something. And somebody that's where at the place where I think this might be something, coming along and saying, I think I'm going to check out that youth group next week. You know, it's the reality of the Holy Spirit and the substance of the presence of God that makes the difference. And I want to tell you right now that is what I'm talking about in this testimony. That is every believer's ministry. The believer's ministry is to release the substance of the Holy Spirit. What the only thing that is going to change this city is you and I having a real relationship with God, loving God with all of our hearts, and then turning around and loving people. Amen? Amen. We are right. We're more focused on the baby than we are. She is cute. I don't wanna just give you a message tonight. That's my cup, baby. Sorry, trying to focus, doing my best here. I don't want to give you just a message tonight. I want to impart to you the presence of God, the life of God. It's my heart to stir something up inside of you tonight that you would say, God, I want my life to count for something more than I'm religious, more than I go to church. The only thing that we have to impact people with is God's presence. You guys get that? It's the only thing we have. We don't have anything else. The only thing that fills the void inside of me is God's presence. He empowers me. Do you know what empowers a car? The gasoline and the mortar and all the stuff working together. There's substance. You don't go into a gas station and pump in the air. He goes, what does that have to do with anything? I don't want you to come to church and just hear some big-headed preacher talk about this and that and read you a few scriptures, and it's just kind of like boring. I want you to come to church, and I want you to hear the Word of God and under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, that it will impact you. See, in God's presence, what it does, it doesn't, if you're in the right place, sometimes it's like good. But sometimes when His Word comes in, and sometimes it changes you. My friend was telling me the other day, he said, after he came to one of the subgroups, to the Med Cell, he said, I don't know, he's like, this was good, but this is challenging me a little bit. I don't know what to take of all of this. It's like, this is messing me up a little bit. And my mindset of that is, I'm like, good. It's okay if it messes you up, as long as you just don't stay the same. Yeah. See, one of the things that we need is we need to not stay the same. We need to go forward in our relationship with God and in our destiny, in our influence. Yeah. In our destiny with Him. So, the substance, okay. Let's go to Mark. It's in there. I'm just going to go to it anyway. It's up on the slide. Let's go to the first slide. And it's Mark chapter 1. Mark chapter 1, verse 14. If you're there, say there.
There.
All right. That's two of us. If you're not there, say wait. I so encourage you, man. Okay, there's this kind of, I'm gonna go on a little rabbit trail here, come right back, I promise. There's this little, there's this thing happening it's definitely here in Canada, it's I think it's in North American stuff. And it's this kind of thing like, that we can have this kind of cool Christian faith. That I can be a Christian, and I can be, but I don't need to bring my Bible to church, I know it all anyway. You know, there's jokes that are like, that's just like, well, it's all, I know it all anyway, I got the thing memorized. And stuff like that. There is this, I don't know, man, I just feel in my guts and in my spirit, like, really, and I want to challenge you and encourage you and even pray about it. I think we need to be people that bring our Bibles and bring our journals to church. And not just to church, like when we travel or when we go places, to school. Because what if God talks to you? What if He speaks to you? We need to be people of the Word. There's something that I believe that the enemy is trying to do. He's trying to make you a cool Christian without having effect on your generation. I'm serious. There's something that's like, well, sorry, I don't need to bring... And it's like, I don't want people to see me walking in. Sometimes it's just, I legit forget. That's fine. But when it's like, I'm a cool Christian, I want to be cool. Listen, you will not be able to serve Jesus Christ and be really cool and have everyone like you. Just not going to happen. I just literally feel wave after wave of God's presence. What gets me in trouble the most, I think, is saying what's on God's heart to say. God doesn't want you to be cool. He wants you to know Him. And if knowing Him makes you cool, so be it. But if you're trying to be cool with just ignoring Him, man, that's not cool. Anyway, just that's my little pitch to that we would be people that bring our Bibles, bring our journals, that we're hungry. I don't know, that's where I'm at. Can like that or not, but that's where I'm at. So Mark chapter 1, verse 14 says this. Later on, after John was arrested, Jesus went into Galilee where He preached God's good news. You know what I find about many believers these days is that they don't even know what the good news is. The good news about Jesus. It's like, what about him? Well, he died on the cross. And he did good things when he was here. He like, healed people and stuff. So what does that mean for me? I don't know, but it's good news. So a lot of believers, like, if you ask them what the gospel is, many believers, try a little experiment this week. Ask 10 believers that don't come here. What is the gospel? Can you explain it to me? Here's what the gospel is. The good news, he said, at the time promised, this is the good news. At the time promised, God has come at last, he announced. By the way, I put the words of Jesus in red this time. He said, the kingdom of God is near. Repent of your sins and believe this good news. So the good news is that the time has come. The kingdom of God is near. That's the good news. The good news is that the kingdom is here. Oh my God. See, if the church would wake up, and I don't say that in a condemning way, you would realize that there are probably dozens of angels right now in this room. You would realize that the Holy Spirit is upon me to preach this good news. And you would be so glued in with me, and you would be so passionate about Jesus, that the gospel would become your very life. That the good news about Jesus, the good news about the kingdom of God, would so consume you that you would never be the same again, and all you would ever do is hang out with God and want to love him and want to promote his kingdom with the intricacies and the giftings and the fun and the talents that you have inside of you, the stuff you have inside of you, you would just give your life to it. But so often, man, I see this thing, and we're contending against it. We're raising up a culture that just wants God and that wants to do his bidding. Yeah. It's going to be good. Yeah. It is good.
Hallelujah.
It's happening. And every person that just buys into it and says, you know what, God, I'm going to give my life for this kingdom. But this is the good news, that the kingdom has come. I want to talk for a few minutes about what is a kingdom. And if we had a question and answer time, we could kind of go into a little bit more depth, but here's what the kingdom of God is. The kingdom of God is a kingdom that is God's. The kingdom of God is God's kingdom. The kingdom of God is the domain. Who here knows what a domain is? It's any, what is it?
It's like several groups of people under one domain or government.
Sure. Really what a domain is? A domain is like a space. It's really what it is.
Okay.
It's just a space for anything. It's a domain. A kingdom, really what it is, it's a king's domain. It's a king's space. Now here's what the kingdom of God is. It is greatest authority in the universe. It is the place where the will of God reigns supreme. In God's kingdom, or in God's domain, all that reigns is righteousness. The Bible says the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So in the kingdom of God is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. So you know what God wants you to be full of? Jam-packed full of every single day?
Righteousness.
Peace.
And joy.
And joy. And the Holy Spirit. That's basically our inheritance. That's basically what Jesus came to bring. He came to bring righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. That's awesome. How is a king's domain extended? Or how is a king's domain exercised, authority exercised?
By the king giving his power through the Spirit to
his servants?
Sure, how?
By them willingly doing what he wants them to do?
It was said by something, I forget.
I'm just going to tell you,
all that's true, but how he does it is he speaks it.
I see.
Think about it. The king wants to get something across. All he has to do is say it. And it's done. The authoritative word of God, word of the king. So I want to talk about a couple things right now. I want to talk about the authority of Jesus Christ. Go to the next slide. It's in Matthew 8, verse 5 to 10, and we're going to read verse 13. It says this. So if you got your Bible, open up there. Matthew 8. I know it's on the screen, but I like it when you see it in your own Bible, because then you know it's really there. You're not just reading it on the screen. Matthew chapter 8, verse 5. It says this. It says, when Jesus returned to Capernaum, you guys all there?
Yeah.
When Jesus returned to Capernaum, a Roman officer came and pleaded with him. He said, Lord, my young servant lies in bed, paralyzed and in terrible pain. So Jesus rolls up into the city, and a Roman officer came and pleaded with him. A Roman officer, he's a Gentile, came and pleaded with him, Lord, my young servant lies in bed, paralyzed and in terrible pain. Jesus said, I will come and I will heal him. So Jesus knew. He came with the kingdom of God. All that's in the kingdom is righteousness, peace, and joy. So he came with the authority to heal him, because there's no sickness in heaven. So somebody just asked, Lord Jesus, will you come? My servant lies in pain, paralyzed. Jesus is like, all right, you're asking me? I'm going to come and heal him. Look what this guy says. He said, but the officer said, Lord, I am not worthy to have you come into my home. Just say the word from where you are, and my servant will be healed. I know this because I am under the authority of my superior officers, and I have authority over my soldiers. I only need to say go, and they go, or come, and they come. And if I say to my slaves, do this, they do it. When Jesus heard this, he was amazed. And turning to those who following him, he said, I tell you the truth, I haven't seen faith like this in all of Israel. Do you guys hear this tonight? There is nothing that stops Jesus from doing anything good that he wants to do, except people believing in him. People ask me, well, if you can heal the sick, why don't you just go and pray for all the people in the hospital? Why? Because they haven't given me authority to do that. They haven't asked me to come and pray for everyone in the hospital. I can't superimpose my authority on other people. Sometimes in the grace of God, you actually can. That's a whole other thing, though. But I can't walk into a hospital uninvited, get up all and just start laying hands on all these people. Why? Because they haven't asked me to. Nor did Jesus go and do that. Jesus didn't go into areas where there was lots of sick people and stuff like that. And he went to every person that came up and asked him, that opened the door of invitation. See, the good news is that you can receive Jesus as your king and be in his kingdom. You are either in the kingdom of darkness, which belongs to Satan, and you're under the dominion of darkness, or you are in the kingdom of God. You're either working in darkness for the devil, or you're working in light for God.
Amen.
Or you're trying to do both, really conflicted on the inside. There's only two kingdoms. See, some of you guys, you've been believers working for the devil for years, and you're coming out of that, and there's still conflict, and God's still saying, he's saying, surrender to me. The conflict with, a lot of the conflict will start to end. And you know, there's going to be a faith pulling and all this crazy stuff going on. Still, there's conflict on the outside. There's conflict with the enemy. Just like when you invade darkness with light, there's still going to be conflict. But the conflict on the inside ceases, and all you have is righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. And you're happy.
Yeah.
And you're full of joy.
Yeah.
There's conflict going on around you. See, I am one of the happiest people I know. But there's conflict all the time with all these people that are going on around me because they're battling, and I'm speaking words into them, and I'm prophesying over them, and I'm saying, get that darkness out of your life. I'm saying, come on out of this junk. Get surrender to Jesus Christ. You know, there's conflict. I don't want to do it. Come on, just do it. You know, there's conflict and stuff. There's I go through it all the time. Sometimes it tries to impact me. That's why the Bible says, cleanse yourself. Put on Christ Jesus. Cast off all the works of darkness. But here's the point, that it was the word that this Roman soldier said, just say the word. How do I know? Because I'm a man under authority. And I also have authority. When I say to my servant, go, he goes. When I say to him, come, he comes. When I say to my servant, do this, he does it. Jesus steps back and says, I haven't even seen, this is another level of faith. I haven't even seen this before. He's like, all right, it's done, as you believe. And the Bible says in verse 13, it says, and the young servant, well, Jesus said to the Roman officer, go back home because you believe it has happened. And the young servant was healed that same hour. Okay? Jesus said, I'll go. The Roman officer said, just say it. Man, he said, you are the king of the universe. I'm not worthy you should come into my home. Say the word from miles away, because my home, I'm giving it to you right now by faith. Just say the word. Jesus is like, whole nother level, baby. All right, boom, done.
Yeah.
See, that's why. Because you say, why is there so much stuff going on in the world? All we need to do? I mean, you want peace in your life? Receive it.
Yeah.
You want some joy in your life? Receive the kingdom. And then keep receiving it. So, we're going to move along quickly. John 6, verse 60. So next slide there. I was going to read it, actually, verse 61, sorry. It says that Jesus was aware that his disciples were complaining, so he said to them, does this offend you? What Jesus was talking about, he was giving this this sermon, and he was basically telling people that I'm the bread of life, and I've come down from heaven, and if you eat me, then you're going to have life. And they're like, this is crazy. He's like, Jesus, he's like, this is a really hard saying. And then he ignores them and he says, yes, if you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have true life in you. But if you don't, then basically you're going to die. And all these people are getting really messed up because they don't understand the depth of this teaching. And nor do we have time to really go into it tonight. But it is in there. God's been showing me basically what this all means. But anyway, he said, does this offend you? It obviously did, because after that, pretty much they all left except for 12 of them. He said, then what will you think if you see the Son of Man ascend to heaven again? The Spirit alone gives eternal life. Human effort accomplishes nothing. Another version says, the flesh profits nothing. The very words I speak to you are spirit, and they are life. So Jesus was saying, the very words that I speak to you are spirit and they are life. Jesus is saying, when I speak, the Holy Spirit, the power of God, backs up everything I say. The words I speak to you are spirit and they're life. don't feel it's hard, just sharing from my heart, that it's hard to believe for miracles anymore, because I'm like the same God who spoke the whole world into existence, the same God who's fashioned each one of us in our mother's womb. I was watching a little 10-minute clip on the other day of how that actually happens, and this sperm gets into this. Did you watch that? That's crazy. Isn't it awesome? Awesome. This little sperm gets into this egg and starts, one cell becomes two, becomes four, becomes eight, becomes 16, and they just keep dividing at this rapid rate, and then all of a sudden, and the cells, when your fingers form, the cells that you kind of like, you have these little webbed hands, and then the cells start dying, just like supernaturally dying to give room for it. And then the other cells that you make your fingers and your bones actually feed on the dead cells. It's just crazy, like how God creates each one of us, and yet I can't believe him to heal a little bit of a back pain or something. I can't believe him to... I actually do, I shouldn't say I can't. Why would it be hard to believe God to do anything? After you walk outside and see his awesome creation, you look in the mirror every day, you wake up in the morning, you understand this is a very heavenly Father who created you so intricately in your mom's womb. Why would a healing or a miracle be hard for God? We go, oh my God, that couldn't be God. Why would God do miracles? Maybe look around. Us sitting here tonight is a miracle. You breathing oxygen molecules into your body, which feeds your blood cells, which brings nutrients all over and feeds your organs. And I mean, it's just crazy the stuff that's happening inside of your created body right now. It's absolutely perplexing. It's awesome. David said, I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. How hard would it be for God to perform a miracle?
Yeah.
See, it's my assignment from the Holy Spirit in this city to be a man of God and to be a leader that leads and raises up leaders that we believe together. And we raise up a culture that walks with God and believes him for every single thing that is in this book and more. It's my assignment from the Holy Spirit. Our assignment from the Holy Spirit, look this way, is to invade the darkness in this city and bring about miracles. Our assignment, if you should receive it, is to invade impossible situations. Not just in your life, but in your friends, in your family, in your neighbors, to invade impossible situations with the power of God, because all things are possible for God.
Come on.
That's our assignment. Our assignment is to be salt and light.
Yeah.
Our assignment is to be a city set on a hill, one that cannot be hidden.
Yeah.
Our assignment is to show forth the glory of God. This is so exciting. This is so awesome. Our assignment is to bring restoration to this world. Through every means possible. Our assignment is to release through our lives the substance of the Holy Spirit. The reality of God's love. How do I do that? However he speaks to me to do it. I find so often, I'm telling so many people, I'm like, I love you, man. And they're like, I know that you love me. They don't say that. They're just like, they just feel good and walk away. But God, that's one of the ways that I release the love of God, is just telling people, love you, man. They're like, because a lot of people have grown up without love, and all of a sudden, here's this young guy loving all over them. And it's restoring them. And it's changing. There's guys... I mean, you don't have to put up your hand, but I know there's many lives that have been impacted because I've been like, I love you, and I give you a hug or something. Amen? We take time, and we just talk, and we just, you know? Okay. Let's go to a couple more scriptures, and we're going to wrap up. John 21. verse 15. You guys getting this? Is this all right?
Yeah.
You guys with me?
Yeah.
All right. So it's after breakfast. Now this is awesome. Jesus is already resurrected, and he decides I'm gonna make some breakfast. I'm gonna surprise some of my disciples and make some breakfast for them. So they're fishing. They're literally, the story goes, they're fishing all night, haven't caught a thing. And Jesus comes up onto the shore, and he yells to them. He's like, "Hey guys!" He's like, "Throw your net to over the right side." And they're like, whatever. And they're like, "All right, let's just give her a toss." They didn't even know it was Jesus. They throw their net over the right side, and they get such a load of fish that they can't even bring it in. And all of a sudden, Peter was there. Peter, the light bulb goes off. He says, "Oh shoot, it's the Lord." He puts, I don't know why, now this is a, he put on clothes to jump in the water. I don't know why he did that, but something about, the Bible says he put on his tunic, we're not actually reading it, put on his little thing, and he jumps in the water and he swims 100 yards to see Jesus, and the other guys come in and they count out 153 fish, and they all eat breakfast. Isn't that awesome?
Yep.
Then after breakfast, Jesus asked Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Or do you love me more than you love these other guys with you?" "Yes, Lord," Peter replied. "You know that I love you." "Then feed my lambs," Jesus told him. Next slide. Jesus repeated the question, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" "Yes, Lord," Peter said. "You know I love you." "Then take care of my sheep," Jesus said. A third time, he asked him, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was hurt that Jesus asked the question a third time. He said, "Lord, you know everything. You know I love you. You know that I love you." Jesus said, "Then feed my sheep." Now, there is a reason, I believe, why Jesus said it three times. And I believe the reason is because Peter denied him three times. Right?
Wow.
You tell the story. Peter denied him three times, and Jesus said, "I'm going to come up, I'm going to restore this man. So I'm going to ask him, I'm going to commission him again. I've already commissioned him, but I'm going to recommission him three times for each time he denied me." It's awesome. Really, the point that I'm getting at with this verse is Jesus said, "Feed my sheep." Did Peter serve bread? Or any other type of food? No, he didn't. What Peter served people was the Word of God. After Pentecost had come, just a couple stories. After Pentecost had come, in Acts chapter 2, Peter was the one who stood up and said, "Men," and he preached the gospel, because they all heard this rumbling, they heard this shaking, they heard this turmoil and the stuff going on, and all these guys speaking in tongues and languages that they understood. He gets up and he says, Peter says, "Hey guys, this is what we've been waiting for." And he preaches this awesome message. And the Bible says in Acts 2:37 that all these men, when they heard Peter's words, they were cut to the heart. They said, "What do we do?" And 3,000 people came to Jesus Christ in one message. Isn't that awesome?
Yep.
3,000 came to him in one message. Why? Because Peter released substance. It's not just words. You know when someone is just releasing words, because you sit there, usually all bored. Now, somebody can have a lot of substance, and you're just not receiving it, because Jesus was the man. I mean, he had the Holy Spirit without measure, and the Pharisees were still like, "This guy's he's a devil," and they walked away. It's like, how could you think that Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, was a devil? The Bible says, because they did not receive his word, they had their word, Jesus' word, found no place in. So some of you guys are sitting here all up getting fed. You're like, "This is a good word, man. I feel equipped. I feel encouraged. The kingdom of God. This is awesome. I'm going to go study my Bible. I'm pumped up for Jesus Christ." Yeah.
Come on.
Some of you guys are like, I'm bored. Because the Word of God is finding no place inside of you. Some of you guys are like, this is all right. The Word of God is finding some place inside of you. To the hungrier you come on Friday nights, the better I'll preach. I just know it, because sometimes I look at someone more than it, because they're just like, and they're just taking in everything I'm saying, and I'm just like preaching to them, because they're so hungry for God. I love when I get to fast, and then I go to a meeting and receive from the Word. I'm up on the front row. It flabbergasts me how I walk into churches, and the first two rows are empty, and all these people sit behind them. I just sit my butt right in the front row, and I'm just like, this is the best seat in the house, man. Why isn't it? The front row should be packed. You know you're in a good culture when people talk back to you, and they don't talk back to you in a best way, but you're like, amen. They're like, amen. It's like, amen. It's like, are you guys alive? Are you hungry?
Yeah, and thirsty.
I mean, I can't force anyone to do anything. I just know, but I can sure, as I'm standing here alive, breathing, I can do my best to influence you and to say, come on, guys. Let's burn together. Let's burn as a community. Let's get so on fire for God. I mean, I can give you one little word, but what happens when you start getting into the Word of God daily and start soaking in the love of God and start when you get a conviction that you witness to people? Because witnessing is just loving people. How do you love people? How are we going to love people as a church without giving them the bread of life? Yeah. Jesus said, you love me? Feed my sheep. You love me? Now you can't give someone something that you don't have. And I don't advocate, you know, and promote going out and witnessing without having the goods. But I'm a solid advocate that when the Lord Jesus sends you out, that when he gives you a commission, that when you're walking through your hallway and all of a sudden at a school and all of a sudden you get this little Holy Ghost burden inside of you, and God says, hey, go talk to that girl. She needs hope right now. And you say, all right, Lord, and we go do it. You start to function in your destiny. Yeah. Our destiny is to love people. How do we do it? We feed them. Whew. How do we love people? We give them the bread of life. Now, don't get all... See, what the enemy does is people that start to get effective, that's when he starts attacking. I mean, if you're not doing nothing... something. If you're not doing anything, he'll sit back and just let you do nothing. You're not going to be in warfare. You're not going to be doing, because you're not doing anything. It's like, I say, how's life? I mean, I talk to people all the time, and they're like, I'm enjoying life. What is it called? It's called sitting on the fence. They're enjoying life until some preacher says, come on, get off the fence. And they're like, but I like my fence. I'm happy on my fence. My fence is comfortable. I like it. I play video games with my friends. I drink beer on my fence. I smoke dope on my... I have sex with people who aren't my spouse on my fence. And it still feels good because I'm on my fence. Life is good on the fence. The problem is, the fence is going to hell. That's the problem. Jesus said, you're on the fence. It's a whole other mess. We're not going to go into that. But the fence is not a good place to be. How did I get into that? Feed my sheep. That's what we're called to do. Are you guys with me tonight?
Yeah.
Listen, there's what I wanted to go. What the enemy tries to do is the moment you start to get on fire, you start to get this thing going on inside of you with you and God, and it's like God's talking to you, and all of a sudden the gospel is alive to you and the kingdom is alive to you, and the scales fall off your eyes and your eyes are opened.
Yeah.
See, that's where the warfare begins, my friend. Because that's where you start to have the potential to become effective for Jesus. Can you still stand up and have righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit? Oh yeah. But you gotta stay on the offensive. So what happens is, the enemy starts to try to get people back into, he just sees you trying to strive in your own strength instead of just doing what he asks you to do. See, don't strive. Just love him with all you are. I say this like every week, and I'm just going to keep saying it because it's absolutely true. Love him with everything you are, and fruit will take care of itself. Isn't that true, Ben? Just love him with all you are. The fruit happens because he's like, do this. I was just busy loving God in my youth group, loving God, and all of a sudden God came up on me and said, I want you to start a church. In essence, he said, I want you to feed, you got some stuff inside of you, feed my sheep. That's how it started. That's how it's going to grow. A couple more things. My aim was to be done by 9:15 and be praying for people, but I'm not going to be that long. Acts chapter 3, we're not going to read it, but the story of this lame man, Peter and John walk in, and this walk up to the temple, and this lame man, lame for 45 years, couldn't walk, crippled for 45 years. He's asking Peter and John for money. Peter and John look at him in Acts chapter 3, Peter and John said to him, I don't know how they both said it once, but Peter and John said to him, we don't have silver and we don't have gold, but what we have, we give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, get up and walk. And then Peter, I don't know if that nothing was happening, so Peter got to it, took him by the hand and pulled him up. And the Bible says that strength was released into his legs, and he stood up, and then all of a sudden he leapt. In other words, he jumped and he starts dancing, leaping. You want to talk about substance? You want to talk about the healing presence of the kingdom of God coming through Jesus Christ, who's the king, coming through his delegated authority, Peter, feed my sheep. That's what Peter was doing. Peter's busy feeding sheep. He said, I don't have any of that candy and stuff like that. I got some good wholesome stuff for you, son. In the name of Jesus. See, feeding sheep, as a pastor, as a Christian, you want to feed your brother, just give him some of God. Give him some of the Holy Spirit who you've been hanging out with. You'll do more for him in one moment. So that, then it goes on, and this crowd forms, of course, because a miracle happens. And the Bible says Peter saw his opportunity, preached, and then they got dragged off to jail because the enemy didn't like it, so they got dragged off to jail. But it said after that, the numbers started swelling. Even more people started coming to Jesus. At the end of chapter 3, it said, then the believers had all this stuff in common. People were being added to the church daily. Every day, people getting saved. Listen, that's where we're going. I wrote in the bottom of my Bible, I highlighted that, I'm like, that's where we're going. Where every day, people are getting saved. Every day. Last story. This is in Acts chapter 9, verse 32 to 35. You don't have to open there, but